the second year PhD student at SDMI. And during the last academic year, he's been really productive. He has already published four conference papers, either as first author or co-author. And he's currently have also one journal submission under review. And also last year, Jingcheng has received the CPRIT pre-doc fellowship. His research focuses on vaccine safety analysis using public data. So today he will be introducing two relevant projects. The first one uses data from the FDA CDC vaccine adverse event reporting system. And the second project uses data from social media.
Okay, and thanks for Dr.'s introduction, and thank you all for coming. So I'm really happy to be here today. So as the doctor have said, I'm a second year PhD student at SDMI. So today my talk is mostly about what I have done last year and what I'm going to do next. So my talk today is titled as Post-Marketing Vaccine Adverse Event Identification and Individual Differences Analysis Using Structured and Unstructured Data. So first is the outline. So in the beginning, I will talk about why we care about the vaccine pharmacovigilance, why we chose this as our research topic. Then after the introduction, I will introduce my first project. It's about using vaccine adverse event individual differences analysis using VIES data. It shows our effort about how to mine the knowledge of vaccine adverse event by using structured data, and we already submitted one paper on this project. After this project, I will introduce my second project, which shows our efforts about to using social media data from mining the vaccine adverse event. We will show our work about the vaccine adverse event detection and sentiment analysis using the real-time Twitter from real-time tweets from Twitter. This is my ongoing project. So first, I will introduce what is vaccine pharmacovigilance. And let's back to year 1000. At that time, Chinese people begin to use like violation against smallpox. We know that violation is a kind of ancestor of vaccine. It's about like to immunize the individual by using the material taken from another patient that is already infected by the smallpox. And to year 1980, WHO declared the global eradication of smallpox. This is a greater victory of the global public health. And we know that vaccines are one of the greatest public health accomplishments over the past century. From the left, lower left finger, we can see that this is a trend of the global vaccine market revenues. And we can see that up to 2015, the total global vaccine market has reached to $41 billion. This is a very huge market. And however, vaccines are not free of adverse event. We cannot see this kind of news every now and then on the internet. This is a news about 49 dead others hospitalized after Gardasil HPV vaccine. And this is a news from this is a post from social media about the flu shot deaths and destructions. And this is the news said that a Utah mom said she lost her son from a flu shot. So we have to say most of the adverse events after vaccination are mild, just like some soreness, redness, or swelling at the shot site. However, some serious adverse events could happen, including serious allergic reactions, long-term seizures, brain damage, and even death. And what more paradoxical is that in the USA, the number of the reported adverse events following immunization even exceeded the incidence of most preventable childhood diseases combined. So why could this happen? We know that before a vaccine coming to market, the vaccine must undergo rigorous review by FDA. Usually, they will undergo three phases of clinical trials. However, these clinical trials from like a small sample of group of people to thousands of people. However, we still believe that compared to the total size of a population, the sample size of clinical trials and the shorter follow-up periods is not enough for clinical trial to find a specific adverse event on specific individual groups. So that's why we need the post-marketing vaccine adverse event surveillance, which is called vaccine pharmacovigilance. So after that, I'm going to introduce my first project. It's about the influenza vaccine pharmacovigilance. The right picture was taken in this building. It reminds us to get the flu vaccine. So this is the influenza vaccine is the first vaccine we have studied. So this is the introduction of the influenza virus vaccine. So we know that hundreds of millions of Americans have received a seasonal influenza vaccine each year. However, some serious adverse reactions after the flu shots might cause some life-threatening illness, even death. And this kind of adverse events can vary much among different individual groups, such as the different genders and different age groups. So the goal of this project is, we have two goals of this project. The first goal is to try to provide a pipeline to reveal the differences of adverse reactions among different age groups between different genders after the influenza vaccination. And also, we hope our results could provide some clues for precise and personalized influenza vaccination. So speaking of the databases, we have used the Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System, which is called VAERS or VAERS. VAERS is a nationwide adverse event surveillance reporting system. It was created in 1919, and now it's joint operatively by CDC and FDA. It is one of the largest vaccine adverse event reporting system in the world. And up to 2014, VAERS has received more than 40,000 vaccine adverse event reports. And one more thing I want to mention about VAERS is that all the symptoms in VAERS are coded in medical dictionary for regulatory activities, which is called a MEDRA. MEDRA is kind of the medical, international medical terminology about the classification of adverse event. It was created by ICH, created and maintained by ICH, which is short for International Conference on Harmonization. So, specifically for the data we have used, we select all the US reports after trivalent influenza vaccination from 1919 to 2014 with serious reactions. So here we mean serious reaction is when the death, life-threatening illness, hospitalization, prolonged hospitalization, and permanent disability happened in this report. So totally, we have identified more than 7,000 serious reports, and 70,000 symptoms have been found. And among these symptoms, there's nearly 4,000 of them are unique. So this is the glimpse of VAERS data. So each year, VAERS will provide three separate data files. The first data file is called VAERS data. It's mainly about the demographic information of each report. So this is the VAERS ID, which is connect the three separate data file. This is the stage, this is the age, and this is the gender. So the second data file is called VAERS VAX. It's about the vaccine. It's all about the vaccine information about the report. So this is the ID, and this is the vaccine type, and also this data file contains the doses of the site of the name of the vaccine. So this is the third data file of VAERS data is called various symptoms. It recorded, this data file recorded all the symptoms that happens after the vaccination. So it has five columns to record the symptoms. And if one reporter has has reported more than five symptoms, multiple rows will be used to represent the to record the symptoms. So this is our workflow of this project. Our workflow can be divided in three parts. The first part is part A, part B, and part three. The first part, part A, is quite straightforward. It's about how to download the various records data and how to load the import the data into our local MySQL server. So here comes the second part of our workflow. So as I have mentioned before that we totally identified more than 4,000 unique symptoms. So we cannot study the association between individual differences with each of the symptoms. So we have to find a way to group these symptoms first. I will talk about this part in details in my next slide. So after we group the symptoms into some high level, we can apply some statistical models to this data and to find the association between the individual differences and with the adverse events, with the symptoms. So after we used the applied the statistical model to the high level of the symptom, we chose we map these symptoms into SOC level. So after we applied the statistical model to the SOC level, we chose some SOCs which had significant statistical difference and high frequency. Went one step further to study the association between the symptom level with the individual differences. And this is our the left is the hierarchy of the major terminology. So major terminology has a five level hierarchy from the lowest level term to the system organ classes, which is the highest level of adverse event. So all the symptoms that in various data are encoded by the preferred term. Preferred term is basically is a medical unique medical concept of a symptom, a sign, or some diagnosis, and etc. And here's the problem of this hierarchy. When we try to map the preferred term into SOC level, we find that each PT could be grouped under more than one SOC. So that could cause a problem of double counting. So this is not good for our statistical models. And so here's how we solve this problem. We first retrieve all the SOCs that are linked by this symptom, PT term, using the DFS algorithm on the NCBO web service. NCBO web service is basically a repository for many biomedical terminology and ontologies. And NCBO web service provide us with an easy access to these terminologies. And when we retrieve multiple SOCs were found on a PT term, we assigned the primary SOC to each term by using an international grid order SOC list. So this is the order list of international grade SOC list. So this order was basically determined by the importance of each SOC. So for the SOCs on the top of this list, which means that they have higher importance. For the SOCs on the bottom of the list, which means that they have the relatively lower importance than the SOC above. So first, after we group the symptom to the SOC level, we fully we first did some descriptive analysis. We group the reports in four ad groups based on cut points, 0.5, 17, 49, and 64, suggested by CDC. As the number of the people who are whose age are under 0.5 is quite limited, we just exclude this kind of report, and we fully like did some descriptive statistics, including the number of reports, symptoms, unique symptoms, and in this like the reports over the different gender and different age groups. So this is the gender distribution of the series flow three report. Flow three here means the trivalent influenza vaccine. So the green here represents the female, and the blue here represents the male. We can see from the right pie chart that the female submit more reports than the male on the flow three report. A flow three adverse event. This is the distribution of the series flow three report. The orange here represents the people whose age are over 16.5, and the yellow is about the people whose age between 15 to 4 or 64. The green is the age group of 18 to 49, and the below here is all the teenagers who age between 0.5 to 17. Oh, from this report, from this pie chart, we know that the people like whose age are over 16.4 submit most of the reports than other age groups. That is quite intuitive because we know that when people grow older, people may become the less more vulnerable to this adverse event. So after the descriptive analysis, we applied some multiple statistical models on the SOC level. So first, we use the truncated Poisson regression model. We use this model to evaluate the average number of reported symptoms after adjusting for different age and different gender strata. So here, we use the truncated Poisson instead of the regular Poisson. It's because that we know that each report is associated with at least one symptom. So there's like most of the data in most of the value in our data are non-zeros. So the zero truncated Poisson can better fit our model than the regular Poisson model. After the Poisson regression model, we further applied the logistic regression model and hope to find the individual differences like age and gender with the SOC. So we first dichotomized the count into binary outcome. Then we explored association of the age and gender with the occurrence of individual SOCs. So after this model, we also use the Spearman rank correlation coefficient to hope to measure the correlations among all the SOCs. So this is our result of the truncated Poisson regression. We use the female patient with the age between 0.5 and 17 as our reference group. And after applied this model, we found that the average number of symptoms per subject in this reference group is 9.8. And from the lower table, we found that the age group of compared to the reference group, the age group of 18 to 49 experienced like 3.5 more percent more like number of the symptoms, and for the age group of 15 to 16, for the percent they experienced like 5% more symptoms than the reference group, and however, for the age groups over 16.5, they experienced like 10% less symptoms than the reference group. And for males compared with this reference group, they have like, they experienced 60% more symptoms than the reference group. So this is our logistic regression results on the SOC level. We also use the female patients with age between 0.5 to 17 as a reference group. So I take this cardiac disorder SOC as an example. So from this data, we can see that the male compared with the reference group, they have like 16% less possibility to having this kind of disorder. And when people grow older, from 18 to like to more than, when people grow older, they have more possibility to have this disorder after the flu 3 vaccination. For the age group whose age are over 65, they have like 89% more chances to get this like possibility to get this disorder. After the regression, logistic regression on the SOC level, we went one step further to choose two SOC, like the cardiac disorder and vascular disorder, and fully we applied logistic regression on the symptom level of under this SOC. So this is the logistic regression on the cardiac disorder. Here it's similar, we take this like chest discomfort is a symptom name. For example, the males experience like have like 47 less possibility to having this this discomfort than the reference group. And for the age group between 18 to 64, they have like 10 times higher possibility to having this kind of discomfort. Okay, this is the result of the gestural regression on the vascular disorder. So this is the gingival blending. So we see from this data we can see that the males compared to the reference group, they have like 5.6 more times of higher risk to get this kind of symptom. So after the logistic regression, we fully use the Spearman rank correlation coefficient to study the association between each SOCs. The left figure is a pairwise correlation matrix figure. So the size and the color of the point represent the strength of the correlation. And so we can find like we just take the example of SOC23, and from this figure we can see SOC23 has a strong correlation with SOC8. And for the right table, we can like find the exact SOC which the SOC stands for. And we also provided this table. We suggest that there's a correlation if the correlation coefficient is larger or equal than the 0.2. So we highlight all the correlation coefficient which whose values are larger or equal to 0.2. So to conclude this project, I want to mention some highlights of this project. We propose a simple but feasible way to map symptoms to measure SOC level. This is the first step to make it possible to apply statistical methods to if we want to study on these thousands of unique symptoms. Then we provide a user case. We use the influenza vaccine as an example to show how to manage individual differences on the adverse events after influenza vaccination using this kind of statistical models. And we also use the Spearman correlation coefficient to study the correlation among these adverse events. So speaking of the future work, we know that MEDRA has not a very good hierarchy. So in the future, we might consider using the ontology of adverse event, which is developed by Dr. Oliver He, in the future to make these symptoms, adverse symptoms instead of the MEDRA. And since our method could work in vaccine adverse event analysis, so we may consider furtherly to apply our method to FAIS to study the drug adverse events. Okay, so that's the end of my first project. Then I'm going to introduce. Okay.
understanding is you are trying to look at these thousands of adverse events.
Yeah.
Versus of the gender and age.
Right.
So these are two covariates, one is gender and age. Then you did this for thousands of different symptoms or adverse events, right? And I wonder when you try to do, looks like only gender and age is the predictor for that adverse event. My understanding is that two things are not critical.
Yes.
But you are trying to assume, oh, because you are old, you get that. This kind of rare event actually is really rare. It's not because of age, not because of gender. But you didn't get the key predictor.
Yeah.
For key predictors like the doses of the vaccine or the name of a vaccine or the different manufacturers of the vaccine, I think they are like.
But everybody get that same thing. I mean, those people, majority of the people don't get any adverse event.
Yes.
They take the same dose, same
right.
Vaccine. So the thing is, when you try to do this, are you trying to identify why these people have this adverse events? Want to look at age and gender. I mean, that two things.
Age and gender are we hope these are two variables that we hope to study the association between these two variables with adverse event. We can also apply our model to more variables, which is you said, a key predictors for this kind of adverse event. So we might we have found some statistical differences. Significant differences about among the age and the gender. So,
let me put it this way. Is any other additional information in the database besides age and the gender? Is any other information?
Like a race or demographic, stats?
Besides demographic, what's the
stats?
State.
Location?
That has nothing to do with the.
Okay.
Any other particular variables that relate to the person?
Personal.
Medications
they're taking.
Right.
So
maybe that's
the
pre-existing conditions.
Oh, right. Yeah. Right. But this data are not recorded in the VS database. So they are just some gender, general demographic information.
Data,
probably is because of the drug interaction or co infection or some other diseases.
I was going to say, it seems the missing piece of data is the incidence of the number of people that get the vaccination.
Right.
So this is just flu shots?
Right, just the flu shots.
Old people get more flu shots, so you expect them to get more. Shouldn't you be normalizing it by how many people got the vaccination?
Yeah, I think that's a really good suggestion for project.
Yeah, it's like a huge limitation for database.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No control. And this database is passive, which means that they can just accept this report from voluntary people to report this. This cannot to collect all the adverse events.
But I think one way to sort of resolve that problem is we don't compare the people that get all the people who get flu shot, we compare the symptoms with, for people getting flu shot and for people with the same age group or gender, with other vaccines. So
different vaccines are given to different age groups. I've had a vaccination for I don't know.
That's
I guess a flu shot. I don't give vaccinations. Since I was one.
You should probably get a flu shot.
I got a flu shot. That's all. That's the only one. But I don't get anything else.
You're old enough for the pneumonia vaccine.
I know Terry Bradshaw said I was supposed to get the shingles vaccination. Done that. I'm not listening to Terry Bradshaw.
Is it possible to make sense with that patient sample and do some genetic study to see whether that you have any?
Yeah, that's a separate data set.
Yeah.
For this data set, we don't know where the patients are. We cannot.
Right.
And also a statistical question is, you try this like several thousand times for regression, and is all the gender data significant for each?
Not all the, okay, let me put it this way. All the blanks here means the value of this like is less than, the p-value of this blank cells is less than like 0.05. So we only like here we highlight this like the value that has like significant statistical differences.
So for the age, you put the age back into category, right?
For the age?
Do you put the age as continuous variable or categorical?
Oh, category, not a continuous. Yeah, right.
But shouldn't you do like a correction when you do that many tests, that many statistical tests, like a Bonferroni correction or something like that? You expect if you do a whole bunch of statistical tests that a few of them will be significant. You do a lot of statistical tests, if I understand right, like thousands of symptoms, right, in four categories?
Yeah, yes.
You're talking about 20,000?
No. We first do the statistical regression, logistic regression on the 26 SOC level. So that's not like just the 26.
Times four categories?
So for each of these things, you give the regression, right?
Yeah. For all the 26, like.
It's hard to do multiple testing adjustments because this is wide. It is many wide. You know, like it's, well, you should do it, but it's not easy.
Okay.
Careful.
Yeah.
Some. I don't know how many you expect.
Okay. So I'm going to talk about my second project. It's about mining the sentiments and adverse events of HPV vaccine on Twitter. So why do we want to study social media? We know that with the background of the second generation of web that emphasizes the user-generated content, the usability and the interoperability, tremendous real-time information, and including healthcare-related information, is posting on social media every time, every moment. And there's also a study shows that 26% of online adults discussed personal health insurance issues, and 14.2% of them will use social media to post or seek personal health-related information. So that's many social media. Why do we choose Twitter? So it's because Twitter is one of the largest social media in the world. It's about, it has more than 300 million active users, and more than 6,000 tweets will be posted every second. And also Twitter provides us with a very feasible streaming, like Stream API and REST API, for our researchers to retrieve real-time and historical posts and the user information from the Twitter. So I will introduce a little about the human papillomavirus vaccine. So for HPV, CDC estimates that for the sexually active men and women, there are 19% and 18% of them respectively will be infected with at least one type of HPV at some time point in their life. And among these infections, one half of them are infected with a high risk HPV type, which could progress. This HPV type will lead us to progress into invasive cancer. And there's a data shows that HPV-associated cancer make up over 5% of total diagnosed cancer cases worldwide. So HPV is a serious problem. So is there any measures we can take to prevent this terrible, bad virus? Yes, there is. So in US, there's two vaccine brands, Gardasil and Cervarix have been already approved by FDA. However, those vaccines have been proven safe and effective by clinical trials. However, HPV vaccines are still remain very controversial, and some people still refuse to get vaccines for get the vaccination for themselves or for their kids. So why people refuse the HPV vaccine? So I collect some opinions from the internet. First is probably the most important is the safety. So since HPV vaccine is quite a newly approved vaccine, so many people are still not confident in the safety of this vaccine. Like here, there's an opinion that said that there are girls who have fainted or even died after getting the vaccine, getting vaccinated. And some people are also like not quite confident with the efficacy of HPV vaccine. Like this one, won't a regular pap? Okay. Like this one, won't a regular pap smear detect any abnormality and identify cervical cancer without the need for the vaccine. However, the fact is if an abnormal pump has been found, that means that you are already getting infected. The second is opinion is that the vaccine only offers protection for some strands of HPV. So why bother if it doesn't protect all the HPV vaccine? The fact is that this vaccine can protect us from the high risk HPV instead of the low risk HPV. So there are also emotional resistance to this vaccine because HPV is a kind of STD, which means sexually transmitted diseases. So some parents might think that my child is like should not have sexual relations. So why would they need an HPV vaccine? And also, there are some concerns about the cost. For the people without insurance, HPV vaccine can be like it's not cheap. And also, if you want to complete the whole completion of HPV vaccine, normally take more than half a year. So there are some news about the adverse event about this HPV vaccine. And the goals of this project is try to find out the people's sentiments, especially the concerns over HPV vaccines on Twitter. We know that now there are many teenagers and people are the fan of social media. They spend many times when they are like daily on the social media. So if there's all the negative. So concerns over some topic like over the HPV vaccine, it might decrease the possibility for this person to get the vaccinated. So for the first goal, we want to find out the proportion of different types of concerns, and we also want to find the changes of the concerns over time. The second goal of this project is try to detect the adverse event after HPV vaccination using Twitter users' personal experiences. We want to find out the users who mentioned that the recent use of HPV vaccine. Then we want to track what a user have tweeted in a follow-up period to detect if the adverse symptom happens in this user's life. And these are our proposed steps of this project. First, we will retrieve Twitter data using the API. Then we will do some pre-processing, anonymization, and to get the clean data. Then we'll do some data annotation and feature extraction. Try to build a machine learning model. After we have this machine learning model, we will fully use this model to classify the Twitter into two. Categories. The first category is the tweets that contain the personal appearance, which mentioned the recent use of the HPV vaccine. And the second category is about the tweets that contain the sentiment, which is the opinions on this HPV vaccine. So for the tweets that contain the personal appearance, we will track this user's follow-up tweets, and we may consider to use some ontology tools like temporal event ontology for adverse event, and some ALP tools like symptom detection, relationship extraction to uncover the knowledge of HPV adverse events. And for the tweets that contain the sentiments, we will further do the sentiment analysis. So this is our currently, I'm going to talk about our current state of, the current state of our work. We currently have collected more than 50,000 tweets, and the number of these tweets are continually growing. And we have already built an annotation schema, and we have annotated 6,000 tweets as our training data set. So we have employed three annotators, and one tweet has been annotated by at least three annotators. So if there's like a different opinion among this among the two primary annotators, the third annotator will be involved. And this is our annotation schema. For a tweet, we will first decide if it is relevant or not. So we will check if this tweet contains the use of either the use of HPV vaccine or the opinions of HPV vaccine. So if it has if it doesn't have this kind of information, we will put it to the irrelevant part. And for the tweet that contains the recent use of vaccine, we call HPV vaccine, we call it the personal appearance. We will follow to check if the Twitter, if this the tweet contains the recent use of the HPV vaccine. And for the sentiment, we will follow to group the tweet into three parts. The first is negative, the second is positive, and all others are the all other opinions, including neutral opinions, will be put into the others group. So if we categorize the tweet into negative, we will follow to see if we will follow group this tweet into five categories like safety, efficacy, emotional resistance, cost, and others. So I'm going to show some examples of the we have annotated the Twitter. So firstly, it's about irrelevant. So like this one. So anyone knows why Brazil isn't vaccinating boys against HPV2? So it doesn't have any information about the opinions of this user, and it also doesn't mention the use of the HPV vaccine. So we just put it to irrelevant. And this is about the personal appearance. Like this one is a recent appearance. Like I just have my first HPV injection, and my arms hurts now. And the others, which means that the user mentioned the use of the vaccine, but he or she doesn't mention the time of the use of this HPV vaccine. And for positive, there's an example that save lives by getting children the HPV vaccine. We can see there's a possible positive opinion about the HPV vaccine. For negative, there are safety, like this one. This mother wants you to see what an HPV vaccine injury looks like. So if we see this kind of tweet on Twitter, we may have a negative opinion of HPV vaccine. And others the emotional resistance, someone don't let their kids to have it because it makes them a slut. Or efficacy, this one. So flat out, this should not be outline. There's miss an N in this word. It should be outline that HPV vaccine is anti-cancer vaccine. It has never been proven to prevent cancer. So like this cost, apparently my insurance would rather pay for my potential cervical cancer treatment rather than the HPV vaccine. And this one, why three doses too troublesome? So we can see that this is a negative opinion of this kind of HPV vaccine. So for others, this one, I slapped the HPV vaccine out of nurses' hand. Didn't you read the couple guys treat you for? So here we know that the also have a negative opinion about HPV vaccine, but we don't know why the exact reason this user is against the HPV vaccine. Okay, so I will talk about our next steps about this project. So since we have like built the training set, already built the training set, we will fully consider to use feature extraction and try the machine learning model use our training data set. And we will fully classify the trees based on the sentiment and point appearance using the trained machine learning model. And we will work with Dr. Hua's LLP group for more details on this part. And I will fully further to consider if this project is feasible to be my PhD proposal. Okay, so finally, the acknowledgments. First, I would like to give my best thanks to Dr. Cui Tao. I was new to like medical informatics field before I come to SBMI. It is she that let me know what to do, what is medical informatics and how to do research in this field. And I also need to thank Dr. Jun Xu, which is an expert on LLP, especially on the sentiment analysis. He helped a lot about building the understanding schema and provide many suggestions for the machine learning model. And I also need to thank to Yi Cai for her like help on the statistical part. And also Xin Yi Song and Xiang Yu for their help on the annotation part. And I also need to thank to Dr. Yongcheng from University of Pennsylvania for the help of the statistical part. And also I need to thank to Henry Chen from UTHealth for his help to retrieve the data from Twitter. And finally, I would like to thank two grants, the National Library, two organizations, the National Library of Medicine and the Cancer Prevention and Research Institute of Texas for their help and study to my research. Okay, thank you. Any questions?
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. From the machine or from the person that you reach them? See, this sentence is positive or negative.
Yeah.
You have to use the person to do it or the.
Yeah, person first need to annotate this like this trees by themselves. Then they let the machine to learn this, like this data set to train the machine. So the machine, after that, the machine will know that if a tweet is like positive, negative, or any like. Yeah.
So first, we will manually, annotate some of the training set, and based on training set, we'll be giving the classifier, and then we want to manage.
Yes.
But that's very difficult, right? People will see exactly way in many different ways.
That's a different thing, right?
Training, I mean,
right. But there are like some methods to do that. Yeah.
We haven't tried that yet, but I mean, like there is some relevant work about that. So, yeah.
Could we use like good to be bad and bad to be good?
Yeah. It's not easy, so. Okay.
Would you be able to elaborate a little bit about what type of features you extract from free text in terms of annotation parts?
Okay, so like the trigram, bigram, and also the position of like the structure of the sentences. Of the Twitter, we may consider to use this as our features for this, like to train the machine learning model. Okay.
Do you ever consider, I don't really take Twitter very seriously.
Oh, okay.
I was quoting the cable guy.
Yeah, so that's a bias.
What are we going to learn from this?
Yeah, this is already have some national like vaccine surveillance program like VIS to accept all the reports. So this can be a supplementary like source of the adverse event. So there's maybe like a population bias for the Twitter users, but it can be like some supplementary like databases for like for our like to uncover some unknown knowledge of the adverse event.
Unknown things since you map it to the known.
Yes, so if we like find some adverse event for some users, we will fully like to. Thus, for these users, there's a profile of the user, like age, gender, demographic information. So we find like many like cases or many treats, many users that have similar symptoms. So we might consider that it can like this symptom can be like an adverse event of like having some vaccination.
So do you have access to those user profile?
Yeah, I have the access to your file. It's public.
Yeah, we make those up.
Yeah. Okay, what's the question?
Twitter has its own language. You know,
right.
So some people they just use non-English words.
Right,
so
and a hashtag and some
emoticons.
Right.
So I'm just wondering how you're gonna handle those non-English features.
This is some kind of like pre-processing. We might like we will translate this kind of Twitter language into our real language. Then we will use like the machine learning model, like the NLP part on this.
So you have a package that can do the mapping, right?
I'm still looking into it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but we have to.
Yeah, straight like that. Thumbs up.
Okay. Yeah, right. Okay, any question?
Any other questions?
Okay. Thank you.
ACM WG 还是 Chair 啊。